Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. I'm Nick Barber. Coming up on this week's show, Verizon demos its 4G LTE network. E-paper gets a splash of color, and you'll want to stick around to see why this teddy bear is so special. We'll start this week's show with a confirmation from Verizon that it and Google are working on a tablet computer that will compete with Apple's iPad. The wireless operator would not provide details about the device, and Google said it had nothing to announce. The tablet would presumably run Google's Android mobile operating system, which can be and already has been used to run a tablet. The two companies will have a tough road against Apple, though. Apple said it sold 1 million iPads in the first 28 days that the device was available. Microsoft launched Office 2010, the latest version of its Office productivity suite, to businesses this week. Consumers will have to wait until next month, but with the new offerings, Microsoft has dealt a blow to Google by offering web-based capabilities to the updated software. That means Office will now include some features that Google Docs has, like concurrent editing and accessing documents from multiple computers. The new web apps are free and are designed to complement the desktop apps. Office web apps will be available in the coming months. Verizon Wireless said in March that its 4G LTE network was showing higher speeds than expected in real-world tests near Boston. This week, it released a YouTube video proving it. The long-term Evolution 4th generation mobile network, scheduled for commercial availability in 25 to 30 markets later this year, proved to deliver between 5 and 12 megabits per second down and 2 to 5 megabits per second up. Tested at a pizza shop on the Boston University campus, the video shows 8.55 megabits per second down on the LTE laptop versus 2.21 megabits per second down on the 3G laptop. At an event in New York this week, Sprint said that HTC's Evo 4G smartphone will be available in the U.S. on June 4th. The smartphone will be able to connect to WiMAX wireless networks in specific coverage areas. In a demo here, you can see the speed of the web browsing, and when visiting abc.com, the phone was able to play the flash content on the site. The phone includes two cameras, a back-facing 8-megapixel autofocus camera, and a forward-facing 1.3-megapixel camera, which could allow for multi-point video conferencing. The smartphone could also function as a hotspot to which other Wi-Fi-enabled devices can connect. The phone is priced at $200 with a two-year contract. Sony officially introduced two new compact interchangeable lens digital cameras and gave us a sneak peek of an interchangeable lens camcorder that they're working on. The two still cameras, the NEX5 and NEX3, offer mirrorless bodies that are about an inch thick at their thinnest point. They have 14.2-megapixel APS HD CMOS sensors that are about 30% larger than the sensors in Micro Four Thirds cameras. Both cameras can shoot HD video and 3D sweep panoramas. The cameras and additional lenses will be available in July, starting at $550 to $650. The company also gave a sneak peek of a new AVC HD camcorder with an interchangeable lens system. It will be out this fall and uses the same lenses as the NEX digital cameras we just showed you. Credit cards are not just for big-name stores and online e-commerce anymore. With the debut of Square from Twitter co-founder Jack Dorsey, anyone with an iPhone, iPad, iPod Touch, or Android-powered device can accept credit cards. A small, free card swiper plugs into the device's headphone jacks. Customers can sign right on the device's screens, and then receipts are emailed. Square Up, the company behind the creation, makes money by charging per use. When a card is swiped, Square gets 2.75% of the sale, plus an extra 15 cents. A new type of display that can be curved around walls or pillars is on display in Tokyo this week. The screen is a plasma tube array, in which hundreds of millimeter-high plasma tubes are arranged one after another. The tubes are thin and all run parallel to each other, so the screen can be gently curved in one direction. The new screens combine the deep colors and fast response time of a plasma screen with the bright images needed for applications like digital signage. The screens will be commercially available in the latter half of this year, but pricing details weren't announced. From Fujitsu this week was the latest color electronic paper prototype from its labs. Fujitsu's latest is about a third brighter than a previous model and also has a higher contrast. It also writes information on the screen at about double the speed. Commercial versions of the display should be available by later this year. Fujitsu also showed off a digital reader that features a color e-paper screen. The device is still a prototype and is just a few millimeters thick and weighs about 160 grams. Content can be loaded onto it via USB or Bluetooth, but there are no immediate plans to put it on sale. ASUS Tech this week showed off its latest collection of laptops made using bamboo, as well as a family of laptops with Bang & Olufsen sound systems. They're not the first bamboo laptops made by ASUS, though, but the material has been praised as a good alternative to plastics because it's tough, easy to find, and grows fast. One drawback, though, is that polymers added to the bamboo mean it's harder to break down or be recycled. The company's N90 includes Bang & Olufsen speakers that extend past the keyboard when the lid is closed. All the laptops will start shipping around mid-June, and the first are aimed at North America. Asia and then Europe will follow. When we think of robots, we imagine cold metal moving around with no feeling. But how about this little guy? This robot on show at a Fujitsu company event in Tokyo this week is designed to motivate and entertain children and the elderly. There are 13 sensors across the bear's body that detect human touch, including sensors on both hands, an internal tilt sensor, a microphone, and a camera that's mounted in the bear's nose. Through these inputs, it attempts to gather information about its surroundings and the emotional state of its user, then armed with that information, tries to react in an appropriate way. If you smile, it smiles back. If you wave, it waves back. And when it's all done, it even gets sleepy.